Bidding on projects takes time and money, so it's important you focus on those projects that you have the highest chance of being successful at winning. So how do you analyze a project for success? I've been doing this for over 40 years, and my companies have spent anywhere from a few thousand to over hundreds of thousands of dollars to bid one commercial project. Small residential projects take very little effort to bid, but once you start bidding commercial projects, the time involved and costs begin to climb higher. No matter what size the project, there is a cost of your time and money to pursue it. You need some way to determine what projects to pursue and which to pass on, because you can't bid everything. The more time you spend chasing bad projects, the less time you have to win good projects. This is the lost opportunity cost of making the wrong decision. You need to keep track of which projects you are successful on and why. So how do you make the right decision, or at least improve your odds? Here are the top three things to consider before spending time and money pursuing a project to bid. The number one consideration is, who are you bidding to? Your typical bidding options are bid directly to the owner, to a single general contractor, or to multiple general contractors, or as part of a team. Obviously, the least risk involves bidding directly to the owner, the decision maker. The least favorable options are bidding to a long list of general contractors. The more general contractors involved in the bidding process, the worse it gets for any chance of winning the project and making a profit. The winning bid will often be ridiculously low, making it hard for anyone to earn a profit. You'll waste time managing and building a project for little to no profit. Your time is better spent pursuing more profitable work. So, option one is the best one, that's direct to the owner. Bidding directly to an owner is often the case in residential construction, but less likely in commercial construction. This removes any middle layers of decision makers that might have biases or add additional competitors. Often owners will only seek three or less bidders, giving you a fair chance of winning the bid. In commercial construction, the chances of bidding directly to the owner is usually based on previous relationships established with the owner from a possible service or maintenance work that you might have done at the site. If you are the current maintenance contractor for their equipment, then you have a fair chance of always bidding on their work or being the sole bidder. This is one reason why it's important to have a service side of your business. You'll get what is called pull-through work, which comes from being on site and familiar to the owner. This limits your competition. Cold calling is a tough business, but it works if you're tenacious and consistent. If you're bidding federal, state, city, or public works projects, then the competition can be a few to many, depending on the response to the RFP, request for proposal. In these cases, you could be bidding direct if the focus is on one of the MEP trades, or to general contractors if there's significant work in other trades. So you're either bidding directly because the mechanical trade is the largest portion. Now, your next option is bidding to a general contractor who has the project. This is where the general contractor has already successfully secured the project and is now seeking subcontractor quotes. This is a lot better than bidding to multiple general contractors, as in this case, there is only one GC, reducing your risk. So you need to make sure that you're not just a check number. I know this happens in the industry way too often, and it isn't fair to those who are being used to price check someone who is being offered the job. Remember, the general contractor already won the project, so it's possible he has used a friendly mechanical contractor to provide the budget to win the project, or the GC used his own values. or it's playing the role of CM, construction manager, with no role in any part of the installation. He's just managing the process, the bidding, and overseeing the construction. Now, your next and worst option when bidding a project, which we try to avoid, is when there are multiple general contractors. This is, of course, the worst possible scenario, as the odds of winning and making a fair profit are much less, unless you're working out of your garage and you can beat your competition on overhead. With multiple general contractors, each of whom has a favorite mechanical contractor, making success tough, and even if you were successful with a low bid, it's going to have to be low amongst a dozen or so other mechanicals. Not a great game plan to be in business very long, because there's too much competition driving down the price. Too many generals invites too many mechanicals. Too many mechanicals drives prices down. If you have six general contractors bidding on a project, which I've seen six and I've seen a dozen generals, and each one of them invites three mechanicals, you're competing against 18 to 24 or more mechanicals. Not a good chance of winning the project. And if you do, not a great chance of making any money. You're just going to be spinning your wheels when you could be going after more successful projects. Item number two, what to look for when bidding. The delivery method. The delivery methods, there are three basic delivery methods involved in commercial construction. The most familiar with, everybody's familiar with, is plans and specifications. Then you have design assist, and then design build. So I'll briefly cover each one, but a full understanding of their meaning is beyond this article. So plan and specifications delivery method. This is your worst option. Most contractors are aware of the plans and specifications method of bidding, whereby an owner, he hires the engineer to develop a set of drawings that you bid off of. Your contractual obligations are defined by what the engineer has put on the drawings and in the specifications, and limited by your proposal language, meaning what you exclude, what you take exceptions to, and the clarifications you use in your verbiage of your language in your proposal. Any scope of work not reflected on the plans and specifications would be considered a change order. The next delivery method would be design assist, which, in my point of view, is better than plan and spec, but not the best opportunity. This is when the engineer provides bridging documents that are partially completed and spell out the intent of the project. Drawings will be minimal, if at all. Equipment may be selected or not, but usually the size and type of system is defined or system options are provided. You will participate in the process by giving your constructability review comments. This is not as common as plan and spec or the third method, design build delivery method. Design build is the third method, and I believe is the best option if you can start to get involved in design build, if you're not already. So this delivery method is where the contractor takes responsibility for the design and the installation of the complete project. Now, if you don't have in-house engineering, you can hire a third-party engineer as part of your team, but you guide the design to make sure he doesn't over-design and it goes over your budget, and you are responsible for a complete operating system. So, out of the three types of delivery methods, which ones have you been most successful at pursuing, winning, and earning a fair profit at building? If you have never pursued a design assist or design build project, then that limits you to plans and specifications delivery method. I believe my experience has been that the design build delivery method has earned my companies the greatest profit margins. This is because you can control every aspect of the project from design to construction, and it's usually a lot less competitive than planning specs. Tracking your delivery methods and the margins or profits you earn from the various delivery methods will allow you to make an informed decision on which ones to pursue based on profitability. One of the company's goals I was involved in with was the pursuit to be 100% a design build contractor and eliminate any plans and spec work unless it truly fit our other criteria. So the next thing that you want to ask, the third question, which is very important, is labor rate competition. This comes down to the competitiveness of your labor rates to those of your competition. You must know what type of labor is acceptable to the project because it could put you at a great disadvantage. Union versus non-union. This is where the greatest disadvantage occurs. If you're a union contractor, like I've always been on the union side of contracting, then you want to know ahead of time if the project is accepting non-union bids. As a union contractor, you are obligated to pay wages according to a bargaining agreement. A non-union contractor can pay their employees whatever the market will bear, which is the majority of the time much lower than a union contractor wage. If you're a union company, then it's a waste of time to bid on labor-intensive projects if you're competing against a non-union company. Some unions will have labor relief agreements or funds that allow you to recoup some of the hourly wage paid per journeyman or apprentice to be more competitive with non-union. So you'd have to check with your union to see if they have such a fund. Then you have prevailing wages or project labor agreement projects. So what can equalize the labor rate inequalities between a non-union and union contractor is if there is a mandate that sets a minimum labor rate for each type of skilled worker. A project requirement to pay prevailing wages or pay according to a project labor agreement, a PLA, attempts to provide a fair wage for everyone working on that project. Be careful if you're a non-union contractor bidding a public project where these types of agreements are normally found, as the labor rates you'll need to pay your workers are much likely higher than you're currently paying. You will most likely be responsible to provide certified payroll records, so there is no getting around this requirement. So your risk assessment for whether to bid or not to bid a project will depend on whether your company is union or non-union, or if there is some form of published labor rate that you must comply with. So to summarize, the top three questions you need to ask yourself is, who does the project bid to? What type of delivery method, plan and spec, design assist, design build, and what are the labor requirements? Union, non-union, PLA, prevailing wage. So now you can take those three questions and assign points to the various answers and assign a risk assessment score. So having some form of chart to determine a weighted value that corresponds to the risk level of success of winning a project can save you time and money. Or you can do it in your head, or you just know from experience, especially if you're a union contractor and there's a non-union, that's an immediate throw out, no bid. Or if you prefer to pursue design build projects and it's a plan and spec, you may not bid on the plan and spec and wait for the next design build project. Or if it's bidding to multiple generals, that's an easy no bid. Unless, of course, you know, work is tight, you got no choices, then your options. So those are all the things you have to consider when you're evaluating these. But those are three of the important things you should be thinking about when giving a score or a thought to which projects to pursue, because it's going to cost you money. It takes time to get the material taken off, to get it priced up, to send out for vendor quotes, sub quotes, put it all together. All that takes time, and time is money. And if you're chasing the wrong jobs, then you're giving up the opportunity to chase the right jobs. So who does the project bid to? What is the delivery method? And what are the labor requirements? If you like that video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe to our channel. Thank you.